Listen and Live Audio presents Don't Tell a Soul by David Rosenfelt, read for you by Erik Singer. Prologue. Friends have asked me why I'm telling this story, and for a long time I had no intention of doing so. For one thing, it's already been told so many times. Television has covered it endlessly. Newspapers and magazines have made it a staple on their covers, and the inexhaustible blogosphere has grown exhausted in the rehashing. Everyone remembers where they were the day it all went down. It is seared into the public consciousness, and nothing I can write will change that, nor would I want it to. But I have something new to tell, information that citizens have not heard, but perhaps can benefit from hearing. I was there. I had a front row seat, and that separates me from the other chroniclers of history. After having told my story for months to every imaginable branch of the federal government, they have mysteriously and arrogantly insisted I maintain a public silence. This I will not do. I will tell it as it happened, and I hope the picture I paint will be as unbiased as possible. It will be daunting for me, or painful, or cathartic, or a great relief, probably all of the above. So why am I telling the story? I guess I just feel like you should know the truth. It's the little things that change your life. They change your life, Timothy Wallace. Whenever Tim Wallace's mother, Carol, had something important to tell him, she ended it with, "Timothy Wallace." She always called him Tim. Everybody called him Tim. But when she was imparting some special wisdom, it was Timothy, as if his formal name would lend it some additional credibility and significance. She was a small woman. By the time he was 11, Tim had matched her height of almost 5'2". But she would put on her most solemn face and stare straight at him. The sadness in her eyes would make Tim want to look away, but to the best of his recollection, he never did. The little things can change your life, Timothy Wallace. What she was really talking about was fate, and how fate was dictated by moments you could neither expect nor control. And then she followed it with the story he had heard so many times. If her friend Donna hadn't taken a bus downtown that day, if she had taken a cab instead, she wouldn't have met Charlie, the man Donna eventually married. And then, since Donna would not have known Charlie, he could never have fixed Carol up with Kenny Wallace. And then Carol and Kenny would never have had their son, Tim. And Kenny couldn't have abandoned them when Tim was only 6 months old, never once contacting them in all the years since. So Donna's deciding to take the bus that day was the little thing that changed Carol's life for the worse, but in turn literally gave life to Tim. That was what was strange about the little things and how they changed your life. They could be good or bad, and sometimes you didn't always know right away. For Tim, and especially for Maggie, the little thing was the hat. It was an important, even symbolic, moment for both of them. Tim and Maggie had been married for almost 5 months, and while Tim had sworn, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, that hadn't as yet included his boat, his pride and joy, his sanctuary. He had owned the modest 30-foot motorboat for 6 years, having bought it for himself on his 24th birthday. It was his place to decompress, to read, to be alone, to think, to get away from whatever might be bothering him, or to focus and reflect on that which was good. Tim's close friends, Danny and Will, were out on the boat with him a few times, but never a woman. Not even Maggie. Not until that day. The fact that this milestone didn't happen for the first 4 months after their marriage was more a function of the calendar than anything else. It isn't until early May that things start warming up on Long Island Sound, which is where Tim kept the boat. He was waiting for a decent day, and while the weather forecast for this one wasn't perfect, it would have to do. "Why don't you keep it docked down there?" Maggie had asked on more than one occasion. She said this while pointing down at the Hudson River from their 23rd floor apartment in Fort Lee, New Jersey. Fort Lee is living proof of the old joke that the three most important things in real estate are location, location, location. It wraps around the New Jersey side of the George Washington Bridge, and is therefore wildly valued for its proximity to and view of New York City. It was inevitable that high-rise apartments would spring up along the water, and just as inevitable that the prices would rise even higher. Tim and Maggie lived in Sunset Towers, as prestigious an address as Fort Lee possesses, and used that vantage point to take easy advantage of the theater, restaurants, and energy that New York provided better than any city in the world. They were just leaving their apartment when Maggie unveiled the hat. He assumed it had to be a hat because it was sitting on her head, but in reality it looked like a manhole cover on steroids, with a round brim so large that the 3rd Infantry could find shade under it. "What the hell is that?" he asked when she put it on. He knew that sounded a little harsh, so he added, "Honey?" "My new hat," she said, turning slightly to show it off in its full glory. "They only had one left."
"So other people beat you to that?"
She nodded. "Isn't it great?"
"And your plan is to carry that around on your head all day?"
"I'm sensing that you don't like it."
"No, I like it," he said, smiling. "It's just that it's among the ugliest things I've ever seen."
She nodded. "That's good. I was afraid you'd want to borrow it."
The drive out to the pier, with no traffic, was about 45 minutes. Of course, as far as Tim was concerned, this was merely an untested theory, since there had never yet been a day in New York without traffic. On this particular day, it took an hour and 15 minutes, much of it spent on the Cross Bronx Expressway, though the name Expressway must have been given by someone with a particularly cruel sense of sarcasm. During the ride, Tim suggested Maggie hold the hat in her lap in deference to the fact that they were in Tim's convertible. Were it to blow out into the open road, he opined, it could take out a tractor trailer. So instead, Maggie's hair blew in the wind, and she was characteristically unconcerned about it. Maggie had dark, curly hair, and in Tim's view, it would look good even if she put her head through a car wash. In fact, he always thought she looked best when she got out of the shower, when her hair was wet and unbrushed. Of course, she was also naked then, and that may have contributed to his bias. Halfway into the ride, Maggie reached out, took his hand, and squeezed it.
"Did you tell Danny and Will you were taking me on the boat today?"
She was referring to Danny McCabe and Will Clampett, Tim's best friends, who often mocked his sanctuary concept. He shook his head. "No, I didn't tell anyone. I figured I'd surprise people after the fact."
Once they arrived at the pier, Maggie was so anxious to see the boat that she kept walking ahead of Tim. It wasn't completely logical, since there were hundreds of boats lined up, vertically parked along the pier, and she had no idea which one it was. She therefore had to keep waiting for him to catch up, and since he was carrying lunch and other supplies, he wasn't moving that quickly. But when she happened upon it, she recognized it instantly. He had the idea the week before and hadn't told her, relishing the surprise. He had renamed the boat the Magster, his nickname for her, and she stood there staring at the inscription on the hull. Finally, still looking at the name and not Tim, she said,
"You think I'm going to cry? Well, I'm not. I love it, and I love you, but I'm not going to cry."
"Well, I wouldn't expect you to," he said. Maggie had a thing about crying. She wanted to save it for the really important stuff, which had always been fine with him.
As soon as they got on the boat, Maggie made it very clear that she wasn't there as a passenger. She wanted to know how it all worked, and insisted on doing everything from starting the motor to steering out into the sound. She seemed to relish the entire experience and got thoroughly into it, even calling out, "Ahoy!" to a nearby boat as they navigated out on the water. After the first hour, they just relaxed out there, drifting with the motor off and reading the Sunday Times. They each had their own favorite sections. Tim was a sports and week in review guy, while Maggie started with news and then moved on to arts and leisure. Tim had once commented that this routine made them seem like an old married couple.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.